I started to figure out that, like, in that situation, leading up to the week of me going manic and having this, or spiritual awakening, whatever you want to call it, my body was stuck in between fight mode and fawn mode.
Welcome to the Conscious Leadership Podcast, where soulful entrepreneurship and holistic mind-body wellness meet to help you heal, discover your soul's purpose, and change the world. I'm your host, Gabby Ortega, entrepreneur, psychology expert, social media maven, and soulful leadership coach, and it's my mission to empower you into becoming the light leader you're meant to be. Each episode will be diving deep into topics that will help you gain personal mastery over your healing and mind-body wellness, while also giving you practical tips and tools to help you create, market, and scale a heart-centered business around your soul's purpose and life mission. Whether you're in the beginning of your self-awakening journey or a seasoned inner work god or goddess who's ready to step into their leadership as a soulpreneur, this is going to be your new favorite place to be. We know that you don't just want to feel happier and more fulfilled, but you want to deeply know yourself and powerfully step into your life's purpose while creating massive abundance around your mission. That's why I've created this podcast for you, the light leader of the next generation. Welcome home. I'm so glad you're here. Hi guys, welcome back to another episode of the Conscious Leadership Podcast. I'm your host, Gabby Ortega, CEO and founder of Ohm Therapy Coaching, and I am so thrilled to be bringing to you Melanie, or Mel as I know her. She is an incredible intuitive healer and trauma coach, and she helps women primarily heal trauma, improve their mental health and generational cycles, and find peace in relationships. And she is also a survivor of trauma, just like I am, And her story is so incredible and is a story that I think many of us can relate to. And we've seen in the last year a great shift in consciousness where, you know, those of us, and it's going to be spicy, guys, we're going to talk about, you know, religion and organized religion and kind of finding your way from it if you're kind of leaving it and it's not working for you. But giving a voice to a lot of trauma that happens in spiritual and religious communities all over, you know, and that's something that I think a lot of people don't really give voice to, even though it's becoming more and more the story of so many. So welcome, Melanie. Thank you so much for being here with us.
Yeah, thanks, Gabby. It's a pleasure to be on the podcast. I'm super excited to get to the juicy stuff.
I'm so excited that you were like open and willing to talk about your experience and all of this, because it's so fucking important, you guys. And just really important. So I think the first question, just to get grounded, we're going to be talking today, so you guys know, specifically about reclaiming your divine feminine after religious trauma. So I think we should just start off by maybe you sharing a little bit of your story and how you became a coach helping other women kind of walk this path of reclaiming their sovereignty.
Yeah. So my story's obviously long and detailed, but the short of it is that I grew up in LDS, or what's known more formally is, or no, not formally, more informally, as the Mormon community. The church, the actual church's name is the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints. So it's a very fundamentalist Christian religion, who kind of known for like strict values and morals, but also very commonly like the missionaries, like the guys that have the little white suits and or the white shirts and ties. That's the Mormons on the bikes. That's kind of how most people know them. So I grew up in a house where we were just kind of a jacked up family during the week, but we went to church on Sunday and everything was supposedly fine. And we didn't really have like a lot of hardcore rules and stuff, but it was really confusing because I grew up in an abusive home. Like, it was completely double standard from what was reality at church. And so having an abusive father and having a patriarchal system, or being in a religion where patriarchal was like the end all be all, it was really confusing. So after high school, I had some different things happen with sexual trauma and just really lost my voice and didn't know who I was, and really blamed a lot of stuff, like my own shame and things, my personal worth, and my voice was so dim because I like took on all of this blame and shame from what I believed and what was kind of perceived to be the truth. And even though it was in a system or in a household that wasn't even nurtured. So, And then as an adult, just, I struggled with my marriage, trying to kind of live that religion and feeling a little bit like I was being pulled in a different direction, or like that I didn't agree with a lot of the things, or didn't feel like, I just didn't ever feel settled. Like I always had issues like trying to be better. Like I was obsessed with like, okay, what can I do to be better? What books can I read? What, like, obsessed with self care and help, because I never felt happy. Like I just felt this constant, like my nervous system was constantly, now that I know, like I just was in fight or flight all the time, but I didn't have a name for it. Like I didn't know what it was.
It just felt like unsettled.
Yeah, like I had depression, like I dealt with anxiety and stuff, but I was like running I was an entrepreneur. I started a business when I was 19. Like I used all of that fuel to like kind of do things in spite of what I had been through. And so I did a lot of it out of like resentment and kind of ego, like I'm going to prove that I'm not a piece of shit. Like I didn't just go get into drugs or like go down this path that like my religious parents thought that I would, because I stepped away when I was in high school. Like I was inactive for probably 6 or 7 years. Was in a really deep relationship with like a Catholic drug dealer. Like I went the other way, and then wow. I came back, and yeah. Then I settled with the marriage and like did, you know, checked off all the boxes in the Mormon religion. And then when I hit like rock bottom with my mental health, that's when I was like, this isn't working. Mm-hmm. But I didn't know that religion was part of it until I started processing my trauma. And then once the trauma started lifting and the heavy, heavy stuff of the trauma, that's when the religious piece was like, okay, this is the last thing. Like I couldn't, there was still stuck after a lot of the physical symptoms and like the PTSD symptoms were, you know, en route, like, I feel like my nervous system was finally pretty much healed, but there was something still that was like, there's something that your body cannot let go of. And I was like, what the hell is it? Like, I know all these things. Like, I know what's going on. I have an idea of what, like I'm owning all my trauma. Like this happened, this, you know, I've like actually have mapped it out before.
Yeah.
And like, you know, what happened, how I responded, what my immune system did, like what Western medicine techniques I tried, what Eastern medicine or like alternative stuff, like when I started kind of coming back to normal and just different things in my life. And it hit rock bottom when I just like every 2 or 3 years I had something major with my like physical body. And I ended up having,
our body holds so much.
Like, I had a lot of just autoimmune stuff. Like in my early 20s I had my blood sugar was really, really messed up. My mom just died and I had like taken time to take care of her. And I just like, I lost so much weight. I think it was like 104 pounds.
Wow.
When I got married, and I had been like my blood sugar was like 40 when I did my glucose test, and I was doing like 6 massages a day. Like I was like just plowing through life and trying to prove myself, basically. Like I'm going to have a business. I'm going to take care of people. Like, I'm going to do it. I'm going to, no matter what happens, like no matter what shit I've been through, like I'm going to make something of myself. I'm going to be damned if anyone's going to tell me no, you know? Yeah. So I like had this mission, but I was like burning through my body because I didn't know what was wrong. Like I kept, like I had such a Western medicine mindset, like, okay, what's happening? Like I knew my body was shutting down in different ways and kind of giving me red flags, but I was just chasing it. Like,
yeah. Well, it's like chasing symptoms. Like we do a little bit, you know, with this kind of stuff.
It's like, okay, well, this is the problem. I'm like, this is what you need to fix it. And I just kept like, I kept feeling like there's something more. Like, I don't believe all this stuff. Like, I don't even think, like watching my mom go through cancer and just different things, like understanding and reading. She actually died of an unknown adenocarcinoma, but she had a tumor in her like chest cavity. And when they went in to extract, like to get testing or whatever from it, it actually bent the needle because it had been so, it was in there so long. It was like so solidified, but it had metastasized to a point they didn't know where it was, like the origin was from. So I did a ton of research and like got into all these medical journals and stuff and reading and finding out about it. And on the other end of the spectrum, like that's grief.
Mm-hmm. Oh, like, yeah.
You totally died of grief, like generational trauma. Holy crap. So like
right in the sacral.
Oh yeah. So like all my stuff began to be like endometriosis. I started having a ton of symptoms with that. I had a fibroid tumor, and then I lost twins. I had a heterotopic pregnancy.
Oh,
so I just like, my body was just like, every time I get ahead of something, something else would show up. And I just kept trying to figure out what it was. And so, after my hysterectomy, I was given like so much hydrocodone and like oxycodone. Like, you know, every time we'd go to the ER, it was like, oh, this is the problem. We can't see it. We don't know. Like every test would come back negative. So we didn't know I actually had it until I went and had like a lap surgery.
Yeah.
Like a experimental or a discovery, what do they call it? To find out what was going on. So when they found it, then I started researching more about that and like both views, like Western, Eastern views, like alternative views. And there was a ton of stuff about sexual trauma, like incest, rape, like all these different things. And I was like, oh shit, like that's totally me. But if it's genetic, where'd I get it from? I got it from my mom. Okay. My mom, when she was dying, was like, came out and talked to us about how her brothers, or one of her brothers or someone in her family had molested her. And so she just had like all of this stuff that came up. And you know, so like doing family history, which is huge in Mormon religion. Thank you, Mormon religion, for that. Like ancestry piece is like, it's really important to know your ancestors.
Yeah.
So we did that. And I just was like putting all these pieces together. Like I got to a point where I was like almost obsessed with trying to figure out like DNA stuff and like how everything was connected. I did like the MTFHR gene. I don't know if you know or heard of that.
What is that?
So MTFHR is like a gene mutation that's really common in people that have depression, anxiety, bipolar. It's not something that they like routinely do, but if you go to like a functional therapist or a functional medicine doctor, they look at the, like the root of your body's issues, like why your body can't handle certain things. So yeah. I'm going to totally butcher it, but it's basically a gene mutation that affects the way that your body processes, stress and like detoxes.
Yeah.
So if you have one mutation, you have it from your parent, like one parent, or if you have a double, you have it from both parents and the symptoms and stuff can be higher. It's linked to colon cancer. Like everything that we have in my family, we had, and I was like, dude, I have to have this. Like ADHD, there's tons of stuff that's linked to it. And so I went and did that testing, and even more just was like, oh, there's so much crap in my family. Like there's so much more to that. So that was kind of where I was at, trying to figure out, I was in a really good place in my marriage. Finally, we almost got divorced, but we like, that's a whole nother piece. It's a whole nother podcast. But
I was like, we're going to have another, I can relate to that too. So we'll have another episode about parents.
So we're in a really good place. Like the best place we've been in our marriage. My mental health is, I feel like it's okay. Because I finally got over all of my physical stuff. Like had a hysterectomy. I had like a year of peace. I call it the year of peace, where everything just kind of seemed fine. Like I was finally in a good place where I could breathe. I had good relationship with all my siblings. Like I was okay with my dad. Like life was just pretty easy. And then right before COVID, I ended up having a manic episode, like a legit nervous breakdown, because I had a week from hell with just boundaries being pushed. My dad, who's abusive, is on his third wife since my mom died, and was just, long story, but there was basically abuse happening, and it was getting funneled to me, and I felt like I had to take care of her. And I went back into like my 6-year-old self. And yeah. I was just like rescue mode, like calling her family, like, I don't want to be a part of this. I can't be a part of this, but you need to take care of her. She's developing dementia, and it was just exacerbated. It was just a really bad situation. Yeah. So that happened. And I just had like my insurance got dropped because we made too much money. Like, it was just like, it was one of those weeks where I just couldn't handle one more.
Everything just feels like it's a house of cards where everything's just coming down all at once.
Yeah. As one of my children walked in. And then I have 3 kids, right? So I'm like going through all this stuff, finding all these things out about my ancestry and like genetics, and my own part of my own crazy story was that like my 2-year-old, 2 of my kids end up at Children's Hospital, but one of my middle son, we thought he had leukemia for a while. And like, I took off work, and that was another one of my like crashes of my body's falling apart, because I was trying to take care of him. But I just kept like, I really wanted to help my kids not have like genetic crap. Like, I was like, I think I can control this. Like, from what I understand and what I'm reading, like, you know, if I give them the right tools, like, their body will kind of regenerate and fix itself. Like, you know, so
the body knows how to naturally heal itself. So we can really do so much before we even have to have intervention, you know, with anything.
Yeah. So like with mental health stuff, that was like, my oldest was kind of acting depressed. And when we were almost divorced, there was just a lot of stuff that happened where I think he kind of took a lot of personal blame for it and just kind of shut down. Like, the light in his eyes was just gone. And, you know, when you're struggling with the marriage or your family is kind of not feeling like it's secure, it's hard for you. And so I just was like, man, I'm not doing this. Like, I'm not going to do, like, my parents stayed together and they were a mess. So what, you know, how can I make this work? So, I'm getting sidetracked, but anyway, back to the crazy week of hell after the year of peace was, I had like this full on, I call it the beautiful mind experience, like where he literally is writing on the walls. That's what happened. Like, I was in the middle of a shift for our other business. We own a lawn care and landscape business, and we're getting ready to like launch this huge door-to-door program. So I was setting up the computer system. Like, I was managing a huge project. And as entrepreneurs, like, you never sleep with it. You're always living, dreaming, like in the creation mode. It's just, it comes, you deal with it. Right. Mm-hmm. So I'm like doing that. And I started outsourcing a computer program called Asana.
Oh yeah.
And my brain was like in freaking science mode. Like, everything had a place, everything had structure. Like, so I got into this zone and like, I just didn't stop. Like, I just started going and going and going and writing stuff out, like trying to like solve my whole life. You know, when you like write a story and you have like the little plot and then here's the characters, like in middle school, I was doing that with my life. Like, I literally sat on my whiteboard and I was like, I'm going to figure this shit out.
Like, I felt like that too when I hit like my literal lowest of my mental health. I was like that, like the crazy person at the whiteboard with like all the colored markers and the lines connecting the things and like figuring out the generational trauma and like what's in my body. And you do feel like it is like that beautiful mind moment.
Oh my God.
I can relate so hard.
You were watching Limitless, and go back to this. Like, I had just got done with surgery, so I was trying to get out. I didn't want drugs, and so I used pot. Like, that was another thing in my Mormon shift was I was like, this is legal. I'm using this because the stuff is going to be addictive. And like, at least with pot, I can be creative and I don't have stomach cramps and I'm patient with my kids. Like, I can handle this. Like, this stuff is good. That stuff is shit. Mm-hmm. Like, that stuff makes me feel like crap. Like, I'm going to do this. So like, I had to like convince my husband, okay, I'm not a stoner. Like, I'm not going to go to hell. Like, I had this whole big, when really it was like, I knew, my body knew that that's what I needed.
Yeah.
So I was going through this stage and we were watching Limitless and Blind Spot, which is like a show about like government conspiracy and like how everybody's connected to all this stuff. Mm. So I think like I just went there. Like, I'd watched all these shows and I was in the zone and I like, I just went, like, I went crazy, but it was not manic, like textbook manic. Like, I didn't go to Vegas and spend a bunch of money and have like random relationships and like, you know, like,
it was like, almost like you like just started straight up channeling something, like something unlocked. Yeah.
But it was insane because I was trying to get my kids in on it. Hmm. Like, it was like I had a secret and I was playing like the telephone game and I was like, hey, guess what? We're on Earth and like, it's just a big game. That's what I told them.
It's like the spiritual awakening. Your kids are like, what?
You know how in Jumanji they like go like this and you can see the screen?
Yeah.
And like tells, or like a Pokemon, like my kids are all into Pokemon right now. Right. So I was like, guys, like, we're really like an avatar, like we're spirit and a body. Right. Like, I was so, so out of it, but it was real for me. I was playing, it was like Pictionary. Like, I got my kids up, I put them on the bed and I had them videotape me. Mm. Like, I was like, you guys, this is really important. It doesn't make sense now. This is crazy. It sounds crazy. I know I look and sound crazy, but I know that there's something to this. Like, this means something. Like, so when I watch it back now, it literally looks like me like giving a TED talk on your brain on trauma.
Mm.
like I'm explaining what's happening, but as I get like tired and more up, like I've been up long and I like wasn't eating and I was just like on this kick. Like I was zero at the whiteboard. I'd go back to the whiteboard and start figuring things out. Like it didn't stop. So they ended up, it's a long time, but my husband ended up taking me to the hospital because they didn't know what was wrong with me. They're like, dude, what'd you smoke? I could hear my family. Like my family started coming. My dad came. I attacked my dad during it and was like, I hate you. Like, I hate all these things you did to me. Like I started screaming. Like the voice that came out of me was like, not even mine. Wow. It was like, my body was just like, the way I describe it is that my spirit like left my body and took me on a spiritual fire alarm was pulled. And I walked through the steps of like, who's from here to from point A to point B of like me getting healthy and figuring out this mess, like solving this mystery. Like why the hell am I so messed up? Why can't I get out of this self-sabotage? Like from point A to point B, I kept going through like everybody that I could count on, everything that made sense. Like, it was like, I was just like, I put myself in the game, like a board game. Right. And I was like actually being like the little person, but I was playing the game.
Yeah.
Like a weird.
Wow.
But like, so I ended up going to the hospital. They admit me to like our local mental health place here. And within 3 days, supposedly I was like still manic. I just remember getting into the facility and seeing all of these people. And like, I could kind of tell what their diagnoses were by just my own information. Like, okay, this person definitely looks like they're schizophrenic, or this person has like major depressive disorder. And like, you could see what was going on, but then I was like seeing their spirits. Like I was seeing them, like I would look at someone and see like a resume of trauma.
Oh, wow.
And I was like, dude, this place is like, this is like spirit prison. Like, this is the spirit prison that they talk about. And like, the gospel, like church or whatever, like it's not a place to go. It's like a state of being.
It is a state of being. It is a state of being.
People are like, they are trapped and no one is talking to them and no one cares. No one gives a shit.
Mm.
Like the crap that we were eating, like it was like
prison. It sounds like
when we got home, I watched Patch Adams with my husband like 3 times because he was like, Melanie, that's you. Like you're the person that kept me. And like you were like Patch Adams trying to help people. So like the first 3 days I was there, I started connecting with people and like connecting with them and channeling shit. And then like the staff would come over and tell me that I was being inappropriate and like that I was being manic. And so they were going to up my meds.
Mm.
Like they were like targeting anyone who actually connected or did something. Like there was a guy that couldn't walk straight. Like he had this cane and so I'm guessing he had like some kind of OCD and he had to count like the steps of where he was going. So I had like this 10-minute conversation with them. Channel all the stuff, put my hand on his back. And I'm like, I have faith that you know how to do this. You just got lost along the way. Like somehow the way that you're going to your room doesn't feel safe. So like, what makes you feel safe? So just like talk to him. Like I was doing trauma therapy. And I didn't even know I was doing it. Right.
Yeah,
so I talked to him about the stuff and like, he gets up and I like kind of walk him through it. The guy walks without his cane back to his room.
Wow.
And the staff was like, what? So like, I feel like I got stuck in there because they didn't know what to do with me. Like I was a freaking rule breaker, but I was being I was manipulating the system. Like I wasn't letting the system work me.
But it also doesn't sound like you had a complete disconnect from reality at all, which is, you know, looking from the clinical perspective, like what we look for too, is like this complete disconnect. There was like, it doesn't feel like, it still feels like you knew where you were. You knew what was happening. Like you were present for that.
And every time I do that, like plant medicine, like,
It sounds like a plant medicine journey. Exactly.
Yeah, every time I connect with plant medicine, I can go back and put more pieces together.
Mm-hmm.
Like it just keeps getting bigger and bigger. Like my mission, as it comes and unfolds, stuff will come back. Things that I wrote, I'll pull out stuff from the 17 days I was there. And I'm like, oh shit, that's what that was about.
Mm.
That's what that was trying to teach me. Like in the hospital, I gave myself a priesthood blessing, which is in the Mormon religion, like the men channel. Basically, you have a direct authority from God to give a blessing or to heal someone, and you have to be righteous to do it, right? But only men hold the priesthood.
Mm.
So that's a big kicker. So in the hospital, I'm like, I'm going through a drug withdrawal because when I went in, they just automatically took me off of I was on depression medication for like 20 years. Like, so they took me off of stuff, gave me Ativan, Seroquel, I think some other like heavy sleep stuff.
Yeah. So just a lot of heavy sedatives and mood stabilizers, right?
Yeah.
Like,
yeah.
Like
I was super sick. I can't remember 3, 4, 5 days. Like I had severe diarrhea. I was like vomiting. Like I was so sick. And then I was on my cycle. And so I was like, I had a ton of ovarian pain because I had a cyst and like, they wouldn't even give me a heat pack. Like it was insane. So I remember being in my room and like just looking around and being like, if there's a God, like I need to heal myself. So how do I do it? Like, I remember like putting my hands on my head and being like, remembering the prayer that, we said. And I was like, I know that I'm here. I see that there's a bigger picture and I'm a part of it. I don't know what I'm a part of, but like, I just kept getting all these downloads that I had like more power than I was giving myself.
Yeah.
And so when I talked to my husband or like my sisters would come and visit, they're like, you're kind of talking like you're a prophet, or like it was almost like my whole manic episode was me realizing that women have the priesthood, quote unquote. We do energy work. We are medicine women. Yeah. We have divine power. We have all of the stuff inside of us. Like, we are.
It just sounds like your consciousness was like exploded open, and like the blinders that had been so carefully placed, you know, around you, so you would only see a certain perspective, like just were gone all at once. Like, and it was almost like too much for the unconscious and the conscious to handle.
So fast forward, long story, another whole big chunk, but my husband was researching stuff to help me, and he's like super Mormon compared to me, right? Like, never touched a girl before we were married, like never drank alcohol, like to the T, pure guy, like amazing, super self-disciplined. He was researching stuff and found a podcast or like a documentary about called Bipolarized. And it's about a guy's journey from getting off of lithium and going to like different countries and trying all these alternative things. And he went and saw a shaman and had a plant medicine journey, I believe with ayahuasca, and like basically saw, like faced his shadow self and faced like all of the dark demons. And one of our ex-Mormon friends, which we didn't know was ex-Mormon at the time, came and visited us. It was like a childhood friend of my husband's. And he's like, yeah, so I went through the divorce. I've been going through a bunch of stuff. My brother committed suicide. Like, we had this really deep conversation. And in the middle of it, I got triggered and had a panic attack. This was like shortly after the hospital. So I go in the other room and I'm like, hey, Chris, where's the pot? Like, and our friend heard us. And as soon as he felt like, oh, like if they're smoking pot, then like they're pretty open right now, right? Mm-hmm. And so he's like, hey, starts sharing his journey and tells us that he went on an ayahuasca.
Oh, wow.
And my husband's like, okay, I've been looking into that for Mel because of this movie, like, but she's on all this medicine, so how does it work? And so anyway, fast forward, my husband went down to Arizona, met with him, went and did two. Well, he did one. He came back and 4 days later, he was like, oh my gosh, I know where you were. When you went manic, when you were in the hospital, when you were saying all that stuff, you went to the same place, but you didn't know where you were.
So your husband went on an ayahuasca journey, like by himself to just
figure out how to help me.
Oh my gosh. That is amazing. That is like amazing. And the fact that he was also like super, super Mormon and he like decided to go like literally from 0 to 100.
Like, he's never had a taste of alcohol and he's going to go sit with some indigenous tribe people.
In many ways though, that's like actually probably like the purest way to experience that level of like plant medicine.
Well, is
to
so
never have had anything really in you.
Like he's so much respect for his body. Like he was so, I mean, like in high school, he was like ripped. He was like, he was doing, you know, sports. He went to state for like wrestling. Like he was disciplined. His sister was a Seahawks cheerleader. Like their family has genes, right? Like the brother is like a gymnast. He was like a Cosmo the Cougar for BYU football, or the whatever they're called, mascot. Like, I don't have that in my family. You got that? Cool. Like, I'm glad that you can be that disciplined, but I like to have a drink once in a while. Like, it was always a conflict because if I had a coffee, he would freak out.
Wow. Like,
I reached the bar, got drunk. He would be like, seriously? You had a freaking caramel frappuccino.
And then he's like, put me in a teepee and give me ice.
And then he's drinking like a rock star. Like he'd be having like a rock star. Like, such a hypocrite. That's a whole nother Mormon thing. But like, okay, so yes, back to that. He goes, he has such an experience. He comes back and we have like almost a telepathic conversation. Like as he comes back and we start talking about it, I go with him and he's like, you have like a superpower. Like you can go there without the medicine. And when you went when you went manic, you were like on a freaking trip. Like, what? Yeah. Where'd you, like, you went so many places. You explored so many things. He's like, oh man, I'm a dud. Like, I got to figure out how to like crack my, I got ego. Like, I need to go like 50 times. Like, you just do it by yourself. So we had this whole thing back and forth. And he was so, he had a notebook that he was writing in the dark. And he came back with like basically a list of like everyone he'd ever screwed over or any kind of drama that's ever happened. And he wanted to like forgive people. And like before that, actually, before the friend came over, I ended up making him smoke some pot with me. And because he had like back issues and all this stuff. And he ended up, like, I came home one day, he found a certain strain. I came home one day and he was crying. And I've never seen my husband cry in my life.
Yeah.
Through all the stuff we've been through. And he was like, man, I was a dick. Like, I was turning into like a narcissistic, like, it was like 10 years of therapy for me. Like, he just went through all of this stuff and had this huge awakening as well. And so when
such the power of plant medicine.
Yeah. Like, once it was time for that ayahuasca talk to come up, it was like, oh, I'm ready for that. Like, I see the benefit of this. I'm softening to it. Like, you know, I see the benefit to this with Melanie, like trying to get off of medication. Cause at that point I was like hardcore on, when I got released from the hospital, I was on like Seroquel, was on all these heavy meds because I was like, okay, I'm going to accept this bipolar disorder and kind of figure out how to manage it. Even though I know something's deeper.
Yeah.
I know something's deeper, but I don't know how to, like, I know it's nervous system stuff, but I don't really know how to do that. So there's not a therapist. There's not like doctor that does that. Like, I guess there's, I don't know. Like, I started looking online. I was just trying to figure out what to do because I knew there was more to it.
Yeah.
But I just got distracted. I don't remember what to say.
No, but like when you're on this spiritual healing and like physical healing and mental healing journey, and there's trauma involved, I think you make a good point too, that like, it's hard to find who can help, you know, because I think that there's, you know, there aren't a lot of people who marry the Western and the Eastern, where it's like, you can talk about how you feel spiritually and how you see energy and how you see feel and pick up on people's emotions. And like, I'm dealing with a different kind of brain, a different kind of nervous system, a different kind of operating system for my computer. And it's like, how do I understand that? And for me too, it was like, I had to literally go on Google and be like, who kind of talks about like all different parts of this and how can I piece together, you know, my own understanding of these things?
Well, that goes back to like, that goes into that next segment of like the religious part, is that that's where I was at. And in the church handbook and different things with depression, like if you go to the Church of Jesus Christ website and Google depression or like what things to do, it's like, pray about it, have faith, like toxic positivity, basically.
Yeah, okay.
It'll
get better. Know, or, like, just like, you know.
A competent medical doctor. Like, everyone would go back to like, you know, medical doctors and stuff. And I'm like, the medical doctors are the ones that got me sick in the first place. Like, I went in, these guys put me on this medicine. As I was seeing the psychiatrist in the treatment center, I was like, is there therapy? Like, we just sit here all day and do puzzles. Like, what's the, like, I need a, how do I go home?
Yeah.
Like, what are we doing? Is this just like a holding cell for people until they like we're not doing anything to help anybody.
Yeah. And that's something that too, like, is part of the brokenness of the mental health system that just turned me off from really going down that path. And because it is really, really upsetting to see human beings being treated like as less than, you know, human, really, in a lot of these cases.
Typifies you and like, none of this is happening, cause more trauma, and then just let you go back to your reality. And then you have one more thing to deal with. Like, it was insane. So like, as I was having this conversation with this doctor, he actually yelled at me. He raised his voice and said, you need to just take the medicine. And you're really emotional today. And every day that you're really emotional basically counts against you.
Wow. So like your emotions were like turned against you as like being bad,
like,
and
being
wrong.
Manic, being too much. Like, I picked up a sugar packet one night and was pushing the chairs in before I went to bed. And the nurse made a comment that they were going to give me more medicine in the morning. Like, it was horrible. So my conversation with this doctor was like, hey, I have trauma. Like, my dad was super abusive. And when you raise your voice at me, I feel like I'm five again. Yeah. Like, this whole thing happened. Like,
to trauma inform your freaking psychiatric doctor. Like, that blows my mind.
I got to a point where I called my husband and I was like, this is bullshit. This is like a system that's screwing me. Like, I literally feel like there's like a gang in here.
Yeah.
Like the staff, like, Like, it was like they wanted to keep me there. I'm like, they get paid.
You know, there's a lot of money in it for insurance.
But I had to go through a legal process in Washington State to get released. And then they took like my gun rights away and stuff, even though I wasn't suicidal or had any, like, I don't know how that all works. But when I got home, I was on medication and I had to stay on it like for 6 weeks. I had like a follow-up appointment with like a psychiatrist, I don't know, like a counseling person. And so I'm a rule follower. So I'm like, okay, I'm going to make sure I get through this. So I don't, you know, I don't want to like have that happen again. Like if I go manic again, I need to figure out, I'm going to stay on the medicine until I figure out what this actually is and figure out how I can manage it. But right now I am kind of scared. Like this was scary and I didn't see my kids. And like, I need to take this medicine. So like 6-7 months down the road, I'd switched medicine a couple of times. I had like full body rashes. I had so many side effects and I ended up gaining like 40 pounds and started having like really dark stuff come up. Like the last medicine I was on was Zyprexa and I was like suicidal. Like I had days where I was like planning stuff out and talking to, like, but then I was like, I have this beautiful home and all these children that count on me and my life is wonderful. And I like, why do I feel sad when I'm not sad in my brain?
Yeah.
Like my thoughts don't feel sad. I just feel exhausted. Feel like a fucking zombie. So we ended up like after talking to my husband forever about it, I was like, I'm just going to switch. I think that I need to get off of the bipolar medicine and maybe just treat depression or like this stuff is too heavy. Like, I don't feel like I'm like, it's killing me.
Yeah.
So we were going to switch to that. And I didn't think about how long I'd been on it. My body's super sensitive to everything. So Thanksgiving, I just stopped taking it and we were going to switch to the depression medicine. And within 3 days I was full on like convulsing. Like I had like shakes, my skin was burning. I started vomiting. I had diarrhea, like, and that went on for 45 days.
Jeez.
Like in the middle of it, I was trying to read Jacqueline Jenkins, Tiffany Jenkins. She was a drug addict and she's like talks about her story and how she detoxed in prison basically. And like, I was so related to that story, but hers was like 24 hours and mine just kept going. Like, I'm like, I'm going to die. At one point I literally asked my husband to kill me.
Oh my God, that sounds horrible.
Like it was like I was like, I don't care. Like, do we believe in exorcism? Like, is that a thing? Like, do people do that? Is there a priesthood blessing, like a special blessing that you can do to like get these spirits or whatever? Like, something was inside me dying. Like, it was like pieces of like, it was not in this world.
Yeah.
It was insane. It was like the darkest, awful. So like, you know, my husband had done these ayahuascas and he's kind of in this meditation routine. So he comes home after running like 10 hours or 10 miles, sits down, does a rapé session, and then does meditation for like an hour. Like he's literally sitting in the corner while I'm like purging.
Yeah.
And then he'll come over and sit with me and we would do Wim Hof breath work. Mm. We would do like up to 10 rounds sometimes. And he would just like hold me. And then I'd get through like whatever the worst stage of it was. And then I would lay in bed and then I'd have like washcloths on me. So I had like a routine.
Yeah.
As the days went by and then I could go like 5 hours without feeling like I was dying. And then I could go like 4 hours, but I was still having all the vomiting and stuff. So that was 45 days. Christmas was the first day that I could actually like function. Like my whole family was like praying for me to like,
oh my God,
be able to be normal. So yeah, that was Christmas. And then up until about, I don't know, 5 or 6 weeks ago, I was still vomiting.
Wow. Yeah. So this was like super recent.
Yeah. So it wasn't like, it wasn't the drugs. It was like spiritual detox. It was like physical stuff. It was like trauma. Cause as I'm doing that, I joined Ignite. I joined your program. What's it been 3 months? And in the middle of that program, I started having flashbacks after I got off the medicine. I didn't have anything in my system, no birth control, nothing for the first time in 20 years. Like it was just me and my ginger tea.
Yeah.
My plant medicine that freaking saved me through it. I started having flashbacks that my dad molested me.
Wow.
And so anyway, so my whole big journey is getting off of the medicine, trying to figure out, like I had done a retreat in Sedona, like a healing retreat, and went down there and I just kind of like I put it off for so long because in the Mormon religion, like energy work is woo-woo.
Yeah.
And it's like Satan's work. And I really felt like everything that was helping me was in that realm. And I felt torn. like I felt like I was like cheating on my religion, kind of.
Yeah, yeah, of course. Well, when you're told that it's like going to hurt others or that it's bad or that, I mean, for so long, it's really hard to break away from that unconscious belief system that's formed, you know?
So I was actually down the first session I had down there. I really faced my rape when I was 14 or 13. And it was obviously energetic. She did a ton of different stuff. She was muscle testing me and asking me different things like, well, what happened when you were this age? And she kept every person that I met there, every single person that I worked with mentioned that I had some kind of orthodox belief system that was like holding my subconscious or my like higher self down. But I didn't even know what that meant then. I was like, okay, that chick's weird, right?
Like, yeah, you're like, I don't know about that. Like,
and then I don't vocabulary. Like, you need to go look it up. And then the other gal muscle tested, and like, something happened when my mom was pregnant with me, and something happened around the age of 2. But they couldn't really get to it. And so I was like, what? So like, I come home with all of these thoughts of like, you know, what happened like when I was younger, and so like, as I kind of crack open a little bit more and I keep going on this journey, I start having all these flashbacks and stuff. And then I get really physical sick. Like that week that all of that stuff came up, I was working with a couple energy workers. And one of them was like, this isn't physical. Like, cause I started having like a horrible gag reflex.
Yeah.
Like my husband couldn't touch me. Like any kind of intimate stuff. I felt like I just went through a rape. Yeah. Like I couldn't be in my body. Like, and I was like, are you kidding me? Like, yeah. I just went through all of this shit. I got off this medicine. Like, I'm supposed to be liberated and I'm still in prison.
Yeah.
What the hell? So as I start like dealing with it and working with this gal, she's like, yeah, it's emotional. And so she told me what emotions were behind it and like how it was affecting my body. And 2 or 3 years prior, I had a really strange incident where like my side was, it hurt so bad that I like fell to the ground. It was ripping at the carpet, like screaming bloody murder. And my husband called an ambulance. They couldn't get me into the ambulance because I couldn't, like, I was in such like pain and like resistance that they couldn't get me on the stretcher. So we put me in my car, and they never could find out. They thought maybe it was like kidney stones and stuff, but that same feeling came up as she was reading me the emotions.
Wow.
And so like for the next 2 or 3 weeks, I was just throwing up. Like anytime I would think about it, or like I would wake up in the morning and I would just have like extreme nausea.
Yeah.
So after my ayahuasca, gone.
Wow.
Like I haven't had any nausea. I haven't had any problems, but my ayahuasca journey was like showing me all of that. Mm. That's another.
My ayahuasca, like she knows exactly what you need to heal.
Yeah. So we did that. And then we did like a San Pedro. We did a heart opener, and we had to do like a silent walk. We didn't, you know, no one could be around each other. And it was hard because I had to be in the same space as my husband, but we had to be separate and have our own journeys. So that's a whole nother story. But yeah, so I'm in a really weird place right now. Right before all that happened, I really decided to leave our religion. Mm. Because of a lot of things. Like I thought that was going to be more of the juiciness we got into, but I went on a different path.
No, but but this is exactly, I think, the conversation that needs to happen. Like, I'm like so glad we're talking about your journey, because there's so much healing and just like giving a voice to all of these things, these different experiences.
Well, like, like thinking, okay, I have bipolar, as I started doing trauma coaching and working more in like your program and just learning more about the nervous system, the body keeps the score, like anything juicy that has PTSD, complex PTSD stuff. I started to figure out that like in that situation, leading up to the week of me going manic and having this or spiritual awakening, whatever you want to call it, my body was stuck in between fight mode and fawn mode.
Oh yeah.
Like people pleasing, like I was trying to, you know, help my dad with the stuff. And like, then I felt like I've always wanted his approval, and like, no matter what I did, it was never good enough. And, you know, with religion, like, I think that's kind of where I started realizing like all of my family is like, none of us are super Mormon or active, but we go to church and we say we are, and we kind of put on this face, But in reality, I feel like the only reason why is because it's a trauma bond. Because in the religion, like if you stay together and you are active, like when you die, you're together with your family forever. And my mom's gone. And like my mom is the only thing that was good about us growing up. Like everything that was tender, loving, peaceful, any happy memory, my mom facilitated that. Wow. And so like the reality of it is that like all my siblings, I feel like are just like, that's a part of that faith or that like endure to the end or that toxic positivity that kind of keeps you in that self-sabotage cycle.
Yeah.
It was like, I don't know. It just came to me like a couple weeks ago, like, oh my gosh, that's totally what it is. But
yeah. Linked to wanting to not abandon mom or not leave her alone in the afterlife. And what a fucking powerful, you know, deterrent from leaving the religion, you know?
Well, and going through what I went through, I was like, you know, if they're whatever God, or like, even if my mom's still alive and she's like roaming on earth, like I've had experiences with her where I've felt her presence. I've actually seen her after she died. That's another thing. But like, she's come to me. Like I know that I've had her close and like she's here. I don't understand all that all, but whatever power that keeps us together is not something that comes on earth. It's love.
Yeah.
Like love is the universal power. So I feel like if you truly love someone in your life and you can see them completely like soul to soul, soul snuggle, and that's like the power that keeps that connection and that spiritual connection alive. Mm-hmm. So like in our religion, like I'm not going to be sealed and like in this heavenly place with my family all together with my dad.
Yeah.
No, thank you.
Yeah.
Like,
also, like, who wants to live with their family for eternity? Like, who wants to be, like, roommates with all of their family for eternity?
Yeah, so, like, just a lot of that came up. And then also trying to understand, like, okay, 3 years ago, we were almost divorced. Like, I could have killed myself in the state I was in the last 2 or 3 years. Like, how I had so many times where I was, like, I'm done. Like, checked out. Like, but something inside me was, like, there's more, there's more, there's more. Like, stay, like. This isn't you, you know, like there was always the voice in my head that was like, hello, like that doesn't solve it. Like,
yeah.
Like I call it rage quitting, like in the game and my kids play Minecraft or whatever, and they get all pissed off and they rage quit. Like, I feel like that's what suicide is. It's not bad. It's just the people are like, so fucking done.
Well, that's interesting. Cause like, clinically when I was in school, it's kind of like what they said is like, you know, when we're suicidal, it's not necessarily that we really want to leave and that we really want to like quit everything that we're doing and all of that. It's more like, we just want the pain to stop. We just want the suffering to stop. Like we don't want to leave. We don't really want to go anywhere, but that has to stop. Yeah.
In that drug that drug detox, like I had had thoughts and stuff, but not until that point when my body was physically like burning, I felt like my insides were melting.
Yeah.
It was so insane. I lost 30 pounds in a month.
Yeah.
Like,
well, so much crazy. Of our emotions are processed and trapped in our bodies and the purging, it sounds like that happened afterwards, and the nausea and connected to the gut, and the gut is so deeply connected with trauma. It just sounds like your body was like, for the first time, your conscious mind was like connecting with your body and saying, oh, yeah, there's shit here that I have literally repressed and pushed down since I was a
child.
Baby.
Like, I got so much, like my nickname is Smelly Melly. Mm-hmm. I went to bed till I was 10, just made that connection. I was sexually traumatized.
Yeah.
I had to have been.
Yeah.
Like, not just me having this crazy memory. I'm not the crazy child. And that goes back to like, I'm the only one's talking about this. One of my sisters knows. Like, I feel like I'm just like, I've always been like this person that has this mask. Like, that's why I have such an issue with masks right now, I think, because I've felt suffocated my whole life. Like, I've had like, hello, like the movies where people are buried alive and they can't. Like, that's how I felt like my whole life has been, in a body that I couldn't get out of. Right.
I think a lot of listeners and a lot of people in our audience, including myself, can really, really relate to that feeling. So I think, well, first of all, thank you for your vulnerability and your candor and sharing your story, because it gives so much hope, I think, to others, and also a real kind of real talk, like you're still going through it, and that
this
is not something that, you know, you just kind of heal overnight. And this process is like you're talking about, like you went through one process and you're like, okay, I'm done. And then there's like another thing comes up and you're like, oh my God, why? And another thing and another thing. And it's so hard, but what's harder is remaining, you know, asleep your whole life and letting that pass you by instead of figuring out what it is that makes you you and makes you thrive and makes you happy and getting all this muck out of the way, you know, first. And it's painful in the moment and it sucks to like have to go through all of this. And like, it's exactly what needs to be done so you can free yourself, so you can heal the intergenerational trauma that, you know, is happening here as well, and really make a new reality for your children, which I know when we talked on the other day, you just said like, you're really doing this for your kids, that like you recognize that, you know, for many children, including yourself, and this kind of situation just wasn't supportive for you. And you're really on the fast track because you want to make sure your kids are okay.
Yeah. Yeah. It's hard. I mean, that goes back to like making your relationship work, is that had I not had like a huge ego wake up, or my husband, I mean, sometimes you can do it if one person does, but like the fact that we've done this journey together, like, you know, we always joke around about like writing a book or something, or like doing some kind of like me coaching women and then him finally helping coaching men and depression and like being stuck in that, because that's not, there's not a lot of voice with that right now.
Yeah.
But then like maybe doing couple retreats or something where you can actually show how to integrate it with your lifestyle. Because like we went from saying prayers every night with our kids and pushing like, hey, no, it's your turn. No, I don't want to say the prayer. And like having all this contention and drama, but then we're like trying to do something spiritual. It never worked.
Yeah.
Like it was like, you're forcing someone to be, feel connected, but maybe they just got yelled at by you. And then you're all, you're supposed to like pray to God and like have this spiritual experience.
Yeah.
Like what? So like we started doing like Wim Hof breathing, or like we'll go around and be like, hey, what was the best part of your day? Or like the, you know, when's something you're thankful for? But like taking that and then teaching your kids, if you're not doing that yourself, if you're not consistently changing, evolving, and looking for the better path, then you're kind of being okay with being stuck where you're at. And like teaching your kids how to, like, that's what you want for kids. You want your kids to always try to be their best and like see them at their best potential. Yeah. And when you're not doing that yourself, it's really hard to practice, or like, you know, to reiterate that or initiate that when you're like, just being.
And kids like, you know, like, and I'm sure all you moms and parents out there know, like, kids do not follow what we say. They follow what we do. Like they 100% will, like, you can tell them to do things all day. But unless they see you healthy, being a healthy mirror, healthy model for the behavior you're asking them to do, they're going to think you're a hypocrite. Even little kids, like they know.
Anytime I do something, I'm like, oh man, like I need to be like, I'm probably way more open with my kids than they would like, but you know,
well, you know, I also think like with, there's a healthy amount that we should be open with our children, because like the minute that we deny that they're individuals who understand what's happening is the minute that they start to repress their own shit, and then they start telling us things, and you know, it's a whole slew of things. So I think like kids pick up on energy. Kids under, even if they don't logically understand or can't comprehend all the nuances, they read energy, because that's literally built into us for survival. Like kids are like, they have to figure out who's safe so that they don't get killed in the wild. So like,
well, they're open. Like we've had those conversations at our house. We're open. Like I've had different times where I've processed with them. Like when I was gone, how did you feel? What happened? Because my daughter, since when I first got back, she was having nightmares that someone was trying to kill me. Mm. Like she was like super tapped in. Like we're like little mirrors, right? So she would feel everything that I would feel. And I was like, oh my gosh, I just kept getting overwhelmed. Like I'm trying to heal myself, but then my kids are picking up and having all of these like secondary traumas from my trauma.
Yeah.
And I have to help them process that too, because if we don't and we just ignore it and act like it never happened, then that's going to be something they have to deal with when they have a relationship later. Like we it now.
Yeah. 100%. So
be open, show them what, you know, show them what I'm going through, be open about what it is, like mental health, those kind of things, like talk about the hard stuff.
Yeah. Talk about it.
Yeah. So, I mean, they're smarter than we think, and they're old souls too. Like, sometimes I'm like, oh, you're so much wiser than me. I just got distracted. I'm like, it's harder to be an adult because you're distracted and you have all these things, but really we're all just like, I feel like I'm like my 12-year-old self all the time. Like, no, maybe 13, like deep down, my inner child is like, I don't want to be like 5 because you don't get to hang out with like the bigger kids.
Yeah. Yeah. So you're just like at that cool age, you know?
Yeah. Like I feel like I'm like, I have like a chance to do that part of me over. Like I've kind of healed the younger part, and now I'm like dealing with the like sassy, like spicy, like, ah, I'm gonna do what I want. I'm kind of chicken shit. No, I actually have an opinion. No, I don't know if I'm like that budding stage where you're doing the turtle dance. That's
yeah.
me.
Oh my God, I love that. You're like literally in the midst of like your future self creation, and it's so cool. And I'm so glad that you're also walking other women through this journey of, you know, self-empowerment and reclaiming your sovereignty and figuring out new ways of being after you've experienced religious trauma. And, you know, so I know you have something coming up. So do you have a group coming up, or what's happening with your offerings?
I just reached out to like an LDS community that is kind of, a lot of people are, I call them closet Mormons, or like, you know, they're still kind of trying to figure out, they're either out or they're like in a mixed faith marriage, but a lot of people in the religion have, such a community around them that's really hardcore that they feel like it's not safe for them to leave. Like a lot of people will just kind of stop going, but they won't do like actual action to take out their records or, basically break up with the church. Like there's paperwork. It's like a divorce.
Yeah.
So, I started doing next week. I haven't launched exactly what I'm doing yet, but, I know for sure that I'm going to do like a Zoom community call where we just have like a support system and talk about like these things, like if you want to share your story or something you're particularly like stuck on right now, you know, maybe there's three other women in the same space that have gone through that, and just be able to hold space for people to have those conversations that are hard and not feel alone. So I'm going to do that. And then I also, right now I'm doing a one-on-one coaching program with, just like a transforming trauma, really focuses on like being trauma informed, understanding how it sits in our body, and then kind of the process of, embodiment and trying to do different practices and integration to keep, you know, your nervous system in check and deal with the triggers and stuff that happen. So I'm going to take that program and actually add, like three more modules or three more months to it, I think, and put in some stuff about divine feminine and, you know, speaking about the religious piece, the PTSD that actually can come from, I mean, it's like an actual diagnosis.
Yeah.
If you don't know that.
Mm-hmm.
Religious trauma syndrome. And then how that actually really affects the way that we process trauma, because trauma in itself is hard to process with, you know, your ego and your own mind games. But when you have like another, I feel like the church sometimes can almost be like another layer to that.
Oh yeah. Like 100%.
Like your higher self, like all yourselves.
It's not just trauma fire. That happens to you in this realm. It feels like a trauma that kind of supersedes the 3D. It's like, because
I mean, and we can talk about that. Like, but I had my Akashic records read, and in my Akashic records, I, in a past life, was like a leader of a religious crusade that actually raped and pillaged women.
Wow.
And my whole reincarnation for so long has been punishing myself for that karmic action, like coming full circle and being like it gives me chills. Like matter of fact, when she read it, she's like, I don't normally tell this to people, like, but I feel like with your mission and where you're going, you need to know this.
Wow.
So, I feel like we have this huge rising up of people that are going through this massive conscious awakening because of COVID and just because of where we're at in the world, like being secluded and really having to rely on ourselves. So I'm putting that piece into this program because I really want women to understand and like reclaim that ancestral, or, you know, if you believe in past lives or not, like kind of giving you a glimpse of like where, like we came from somewhere else before we were here.
Yeah.
And all of that information and that power and that coding is in our system, and we can hack it.
Yeah.
Like when I went manic, I kept saying, I hacked my brain. Like
we hack the matrix. We do it every day too in meditation.
Yeah, like how do you do that? Because it's such to get from point A to point B, like where I was at, like being on medication and being like suicidal to where I am now a year later is insane.
Like it's so fast, so fast. And like, I mean, you've been working on yourself like a really long time and deconstructing, it sounds like, just tapping at the door of that for a long time. But
yeah, there's definitely lots of pieces, but like being able to put that together and help other women go like, hey, you know, you have been doing this for a long time. It's not like you're just quitting on your family or faith. Like, you've had other things, you know, that you've gone through. And a lot of those other things are pieces that religion has kind of helped you stay stuck. It's like the glue that kind of keeps the shame there. Like you can kind of get over something, but if you think that God's judging you, or like that your friends, or, you know, just just that outside influence, like it's hard to let it go.
Yeah, absolutely. Oh my God. And they're so lucky to have you, Mel, to be lighting the way. And the fact that you stepped into this yourself and faced really, really deep, dark, painful shadows that, you know, so many of us just would rather keep our head in the sand.
But like, what is that, ostrich?
Yeah, like, right. It's just like ostrich, like that's just easier to stay over here, you know, to break that down for yourself. And then the layers, like you're saying, of trauma that you have, you know, there's sexual trauma, there's emotional trauma, right? Relational trauma. There's, you know, feelings of like identity, almost trauma, because it's like you think you're one person this for a really long time with all of these rules and beliefs, and then you crack open and realize that that's not truly who you are, and that your soul and spirit and love and like all of, you know, there's not so much to be afraid of. It's actually kind of a pretty exciting world if you're open to it. And that's powerful.
If you have someone to hold your hand, like doing it by yourself,
it's like waking scary up in a cave
without a flashlight in the middle of nowhere on a cliff is freaking scary.
Yes.
But
yes.
But if you're like looking around and you got a little person to flash, like, hey, what's up, dude? I've been here for 2 weeks.
That's Mel. Like, go hang out with Mel. She will grab your hand. She will hold the flashlight. She'll walk to you. Yeah. Through.
I've been in the cave and it sucks.
Yes.
And I have a light.
And you don't have to do alone, you know? And I think like, but there aren't that many who know how to walk this path. And I will say that. And if you're looking for, you know, anyone with like massive amounts of integrity who really is doing this work and actually like ethically standing where you're going to stand and doing the things that you're going to do and like really understands what you're going through, like Mel is the person. And I know, and I fully, truly, like, I believe in what you're doing so deeply. You know, I come from a Cuban family that like my mom and dad were not very religious, but they had their own traumas around Catholicism and the abuse that happens.
Culture, we didn't talk about culture, but culture and religious and culture together is like
huge. So there's so much deconstructing that needs to happen, because at the end of the day, no matter what you believe in, we really have to reconcile that it can't be a punishment. It can't be this, whatever we're thinking about. It's like there's much more love involved and it doesn't have to be so punitive.
Like it's hard to reach things when you have all these obstacles and all these walls up. Like I'm like the blow the shit down. Like I want to like I want to send a line. Like we joke around in our business that like when we had a new employee onboarding, like I would be the one that would row them out in the boat and like put a life jacket on them and pack them a snack and like have a wagon with extra stuff and like a flashlight if they got lost. And my husband was the one that was like, here's half a floaty. It's inflated. It has a hole in it, but like there might be a patch on the way. So like we've joked around, but that's how we would like navigate life. And like here we are now, like the same kind of people, but doing it for other people. And it's super cool because like they used to make fun of me, but I'm like, guys, I'm doing it and people are loving it. So
oh my God. Well, congratulations and really like truly congratulations on everything you've been able to do for yourself, how your husband has jumped in, like how you guys are like dream team, like way to set the standard high. And I know like and your kids are gonna be like so grateful, I'm sure, and they are, and just a beautiful mirror for all of us, you know, who are struggling with leaving perhaps a traumatic religious situation and have a lot of family that make it very hard and our guilt and our shame and the confusion. So you guys go check out Mel. Her handle is mel.unfiltered, and I'll put all of her information in the show notes. She has just, as you can tell, just the biggest, best, greatest heart, and will hold tremendous space for you and will hold that flashlight, and she'll make it fun. She's also hella fun and like super down to earth. So just like go check her out. And any like last words of wisdom for, you know, our audience as we leave today?
I have a couple things real quick. I wanted to throw in there conscious canes. I haven't really pushed it yet, but like, we bought a fifth wheel, and part of our journey of like just piecing out and starting over is we're traveling this summer with our kids and just kind of show them. We might come down and see Gabby. I don't know. Like,
yes,
we have these different plans, but, I started talking about kind of where we were, I guess, a family and sharing that journey. Cause I really, that's like how I'm roping my husband into, like, he's ready to help guys coach. Like coaching people, but he's doesn't think he's ready. So like I started this thing, I branded it and everything, Conscious Canes. It's on Instagram, and it's just kind of our journey of how we're doing it together. So if you want to check that out, that's that. But then I think just like what I want to leave is like your timing is everything. Like wherever you're at, and I truly, truly, I used to hate this. I used to hate when people are like, you have to love yourself like before you can get better. And like, I don't even know what the fuck that means. Like, what does that mean? Like, no.
No, I get that. I felt the same way too for, yeah.
But like, honestly, from where I was to where I'm at, like every single thing taught me something. Like I had a lot of crap growing up. I had a lot of stuff that was hard. And I don't know if I would go back and do, I wouldn't go back and do it over because I'm a badass right now. Yeah. And I love who I am right now. Like for the first time in my life, I love my body. I just love me because I went through it, because I have, like, I can own it and be like, hey, I went through all of this shit and I'm still shining.
Yeah.
So like wherever you're at, if you're in a hard place, like own that place, like you're doing the work. Mm. It sucks. But that hard stuff is like, that's where the juicy shit comes out. So just, I don't know, trust in your timing and trust in the place where you're at, because it's going to turn into something beautiful.
Oh my gosh. I'm like framing that on my wall. I think I needed to hear that today. So thank you for channeling that for me.
Yeah.
Oh, well, thank you so much, Mel, for being here. And I will drop everything about Conscious Canes, about your page, and about all things Mel in the show notes, so you guys can find her and let her be your guide. She's incredible. And I love her so much. And it's been an honor working with you and hanging out with you. And I'm sure this is just the beginning.
Yeah, that's the beginning. I'm going to do like a newsletter, I think, like the Daily Mail.
Oh my God, the Daily Mail. Oh my God, I love that. Well, we will look forward to that. Absolutely. Thanks.
Okay, awesome. Thanks, Gabby.
See you soon. Yeah. All right, guys, till next time, take good care of yourselves and try to like yourselves if you can't love yourself yet. Just get like, start with just like or just accept and trust where you are. She's right. It all happens in due timing. And that's our episode for today, guys. Thank you so much for joining us at the Conscious Leadership Podcast. I'm so excited. This next year, 2021, is going to be huge. We have so many guests that are coming on that you're going to love. I'm going to be doing some more solo casts and home therapy coaching. We have so many things rolling out for you. Retreats, another round of Ignite starting in May, another one starting at the end of the summer, a mastermind, and so many other things. So be sure to stay tuned with us on Instagram. Follow me at @om_therapy_coaching and stay tuned for so much goodness coming up. As always, I would love to hear your feedback. Head over to iTunes and leave us a review, and I would love to give you a free copy of my subconscious reprogramming workbook, and that is absolutely free. Just send me a screenshot of your review and on Instagram, and I will be so happy to send that over as my gift for you. And I am sending you so many hugs, so much love, and I hope that this week you are able to find just a little bit more joy in your life. Have a good one, guys.